Den können wir doch endlich mal anbieten. So.
Present, Yona.
Mr. Kenneth Chesa.
Present, Yona.
For the accused person.
Good afternoon, once again, Your Honor. My name is Owiti. I appear together with Mr. Gachoka.
Present, Yona.
And Ms. Karaoke for the Republic.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. For the victim, my name is Dunstan Omari, together with MS Sophie Nekesi.
Good afternoon, Your
Yes, Yona, we understand that this matter is coming up for arguments as regards pay. From the onset, the Republic opposes vehemently the release of the accused person on bail. For the single reason that there are compelling reasons to deny the accused person bail. And that will take the shortest period of time to lay both the legal and factual basis establishing the existence of compelling reasons. Justify this court's denial of bail against the accused person. You know, I'll introduce our arguments on the law, then my learned colleagues will take it up on the factual matrix. Your Honor, we trust the court's appreciation of the law on the question of bond. I think the superior courts have exhausted issues around it. But our application to deny the accused bail is based on Article 49(1)(h). Section 123 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Section 123, capital A of the Criminal Procedure Code. And paragraph 4.9 A to L of the Judiciary Bail and Bond Policy Guidelines. Your Honor, we preempt that the defense will tell you that bail is a constitutional right. We easily concede to that argument when they make it, that the right to bail is protected under Article 49(1). However, the same Article 49(1)(h) allows for the limitation of the right to bail. To the extent, therefore, that the right to bail is not absolute. You know, that limitation of the right to bail under Article 49(1)(h) is in line with Article 24 of the Constitution on the limitation of constitutional rights. And therefore, that it is our argument that denying the accused person before you bail would meet the threshold under Article 24 for limiting the right to liberty and the right to security of the person in an open and democratic society as is Kenya. The second argument that the defense is most likely going to raise is that there is a presumption of innocence. Again, we easily concede that every accused person has, under Article 50, Sub-Article 2A, the right to be presumed innocent. But the superior courts of this land, including in Abolfati versus Republic, a Supreme Court decision, has held that a denial of bail is not a violation of the right to fair trial and the right to be presumed innocent. That is a serious offense. So that,
Your Honor, sorry to object, but I don't know if JV is actually intimating that the bench is actually a party to this matter by indicating that bringing the bench into the forum of the complainants. I think that's not right.
Your Honor, Mr. Okatch does not require an answer to that. It is rhetoric, so I'll proceed.
Okay, let's not interfere. We'll give you a chance to rebut or otherwise. Give a suggestion that the bench is not part of the proceeding.
For the avoidance of doubt, we do not intend to indicate that the bench is a party.
So I think I have to proceed.
Yes. And the intention is to actually derail me, so let me just try and get it back.
Okay.
Your Honor, it is our argument that the offense before you is of utmost seriousness. And if you look at both Section 123, capital A, and paragraph 4.9, A to L, the number one compelling reason, or in the words of Section 123, capital A, exclusion to the bail and bond is the seriousness of the offense. Having said as much, Your Honor, with that uncompelling reason, allow me to just talk about two issues on the law. That the burden of proof of the existence of compelling reasons is, without a doubt, belongs to the prosecution. And that's why we are making these arguments. However, and more importantly, that the standard of proof of the existence of compelling reasons is merely on a balance of probabilities, so that that should not be confused with the standard of proof in ordinary criminal trials. So that if this court finds on a balance of probabilities that there exists just one compelling reason, just one compelling reason on a balance of probabilities, then this court must deny the accused person bail. And allow me to address the last bit of must deny. While bail is a constitutional right, the Constitution commands that where there are compelling reasons, bail must be declined. So that the only discretion left is where their bail is granted, the court has a discretion to impose bail terms and conditions. However, if you find that there are compelling reasons, you must deny bail. To conclude, our application to deny the accused person bail is in the interest of justice. It is in the interest of the administration of the criminal justice. And Your Honor, I dare say that this court has a duty to send a warning to other would-be perpetrators of assault against law enforcement officers, that you cannot just assault a police officer. For whatever reason, even if he asks for 10,000 as bribe, as has been peddled in the media, that should not, may not go on record, my Your Honor. But for whatever reason, even if, even if a police officer were to ask for a bribe,
as they do,
even if, then that should not be a reason for a police officer to be assaulted and to be robbed, as is particularized in the charge sheet. You know, I will conclude by preempting arguments around a possible assault and or torture of the accused person, because the defense already intimated to it in the morning, and I may not have a chance to respond. Or maybe my colleagues will have a chance to respond. Your Honor, that while we take the alleged offenses against the accused person very seriously, the state equally takes allegations of assault against an accused person or any other person very seriously. If the allegations are that there were any officers who assaulted the accused person, and I'm glad Mr. Ndegwa and Mr. Okach were with me when we handled, before Honorable Nina, a similar case against Honorable Babu Owino, in which, and Gaucho, in which they were alleged to have been assaulted.
Yes, the only difference is that it's becoming preemptive after the victim has actually visited the hospital and before an application of that nature is made.
Then I'm allowed to preempt. If they don't want to make it, they can drop it. Yes. So I'm saying I am lucky that they're with me on the other side, because Honorable Nina dealt with that. It's not binding on you, but we will humbly persuade you that if the allegations that the accused person was assaulted by police officers, as I suspect it will be made, then the proper way to deal with that is to advise that the accused person be advised to visit IPOA so that a formal complaint is made about the specific officers or the specific police station. Because inviting you to talk or address the issues of the alleged assault would reduce this judicial office into an investigative agency. The only institution that is mandated and vested with powers to investigate allegations of misconduct against police officers is the Independent Policing Authority. So that issue cannot arise as part of the argument for one. You know, I've said enough. I will invite my colleagues, and thank you very much. I pray that the court may allow me to leave any time. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
Good afternoon, Counsel.
Your Honor, I'll be taking the court through the compelling reasons as contained in an affidavit dated 5th June 2024, which is deponed by PC Josephat Rotich, a detective attached to DCI Kasarani, and who is the investigating officer in this matter. Your Honor, the affidavit has been served on the accused respondent. And the matter before you was commenced by a report being made at Kasarani Police Station. In OB number 2 of that June 2024. You know, at the time that report was made, the accused respondent was still at large. And he was only arrested on the 3rd. Was only arrested, Your Honor, from where he was hiding from. And
object cannot submit from the bar with such kind of weight issues that affect the right of an individual. He needs to refer to us in the affidavit where that has been deponed. Where exactly is that averment in the affidavit that he's referring
paragraph
to?
Paragraph
8. Yeah, in respect to whatever you are referring to. Read for us, you see. Because you cannot refer to matters or materials that are before the court.
Your Honor, can you protect me from...
You're not under any attack.
I'm under attack from three counsels,
Your Honor. We are protecting the integrity of the process and the integrity of this court so that he does not make submissions from social media when we are appearing here from a court of law and is holding an affidavit.
Your
we are saving judicial time.
And I think this affidavit...
You're not the DPP. The DPP is
able
to respond.
I almost was. So, affidavit dated 5th June 2024, what my good brother is talking to is what has been posted a few minutes ago. It can't be in the affidavit.
Your Honor,
I think let's not forget.
Let him proceed.
You know, according to Mr. Shoke, his invocation is on.
The judicial notice.
So you can
and it's a matter of public notoriety.
Yeah, but you know, judicial notice must be a matter of notoriety.
Yes.
That is not notorious to us. We are not in custody of that information. It's not notorious to us.
It is notorious to everyone else apart from me in this court.
All right.
We'll get to a chance.
All right.
Your Honor, having regards to those overtures which have been made to interfere with witnesses, will be pleading with this court to deny the accused person's bond. And to be guided by paragraph 8E of the affidavit, it is deponed that the complainant feels victimized on social media and has requested to testify before the accused person is released. That, Your Honor, would be a change of circumstance where the accused person can approach this court after the complainant has testified to seek for bail and bond. Your Honor, you will also note that we did serve the affidavit. We have not received a formal response to that affidavit. We have also not received a formal notice to cross-examine the deponent. And we will thus be seeking the court to be guided by the allowance in that affidavit.
Mine is just a few things. And I wish to invite the court to look at paragraph 8, sub-paragraph 8. You know, why we are telling the court that the accused person is a flight risk? We hope the court has had the benefit of seeing the video that has been circulating concerning the offense. And you know, the accused person committed offense around the morning hours. You know, he was not arrested until the hours of night for the very reason, you know, that he went into hiding. The police officers were scouting for him until they got to wind that during the night he had made his way to his mother's house. And this is a demonstration of the capability of the accused person. Your Honor, I would wish to speak for the victim. I know Mr. Omari is here. And to ask the court, yesterday when we were in court, our members of the, I don't want to say they are members of the family, but they were coming for the accused person. Your Honor, they took videos, which ended up on sites like Tuko. And you know, these efforts are just re-victimizing the complainant. You know, we wonder what will happen if he's let out at this point. A mockery is being made of this case. Actually, when this case is such a serious offense, in other jurisdictions, you know, it attracts even a penalty of death. Yes. In the states, you know, I don't know which.
Almost all
states in the U.S.
But you appreciate being in Kenya.
Yes, I do appreciate. But you know, that is why we borrow jurisprudence from others. And you know, a mockery of what happened to the complainant is what is being propagated. And lastly, you know, the seriousness of the offense. You know, the fact that a 57-year-old policeman was given service to the Republic of Kenya for over 4 decades was assaulted while in uniform, dragged down. And you know, this pained the members of the public who were there. But they chased after the accused person. You know, this offense is serious. It sends a message to the entire country. How do we treat our officers? How do we treat any member, any public servant? And it is my position that we have laid compelling grounds before you to deny the accused person, especially for the court to have the request of the complainant attacked, who is the victim, to first testify before in consideration of the application or bond can be considered by the court. Now, the same is in the interest of justice.
We're in the same team on behalf of the victim.
Yes, Your Honor, perhaps before Mr. Omari addresses you, and now that he has confirmed that he's on the same team, you need to give the scope and direction of the scope of his participation pursuant to Section 9, subsection 2A of the victim's protection. Your Honor, in our humble view, Mr. Omari, at this particular stage, has no audience before you in respect to the matters before you. You know, this was held in the case of Waswa versus the DPP in petition number 23 of 2019, the Supreme Court decision, at paragraph 7. Having confirmed that he's with the DPP, he cannot be a secondary prosecutor. His role must be very well defined. And he can only address the question of how will the granting of bail affect victims, if at all there was a victim. Because that now is an allegation that a victim exists.
So I think the jurisprudence on the victim, the role of the victim or the place of the victim in the trial process.
That's correct.
It's not in doubt here.
That's
and
correct.
I think that citation you cited, I think, is a guiding light on the issue of the victim. But obviously, I think the ratio in that matter is that the scope of the counsel watching brief for the victim is quite limited.
Yes, sir.
Because they cannot take the role of the DPP.
Yes.
As much as he was just about to be a DPP.
I do not
assume the role of the DPP in that matter. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
So I think, Mr. Omari, I think you're very limited because I believe the other counsel has actually argued very.
Your Honor, I know exactly.
And Your Honor, before he submits, he can only submit on paragraph 8, clause E of
yes,
the affidavit.
First of all, what he has to say. Yeah, and
because that is what touches on the victim in this particular affidavit.
Sure. Your Honor. I do confirm that that position of the DPP is not available for the next 7 years. So let him not worry. I'll address my point based on the complainant and the victim. I want to define who I'm addressing on behalf. The assaulted police officer is the complainant in this matter. His voice is mandatory before the petition on bail or bond is heard. The family of the victim's voice is mandatory. The family is all police officers in this country. That is the family of the complainant. Their voice needs to be heard. Let me start with the fact the complainant, Your Honor. They charge it in count 2. Reads that on the second day of June 2024, the committee road in Kasarani sub-county within Nairobi County unlawfully did grievous harm to one Jacob Ogendo. The complainant was grievously harmed. The import of that, in the event he dies, within 1 year and 1 day, accused shall stand charged with the offense of murder. That is the first angle. Number two, the effect of those injuries need to be ascertained medically to bring into perspective the seriousness of the offense. Third, Your Honor, the victim is a 57-year-old police officer with children, with a wife, with the mothers-in-law and the fathers-in-law, with the uncles, who are looking at him, one as a failure, two, a 57-year-old brought down by a 19-year-old. That effect on his self-esteem is devastating. He will definitely need a lot of counseling. That is trauma that cannot be taken lightly. Then I could have taken an affidavit from the complainant to bring to you. He's unable to swear that due to the beatings and the medical condition he's in. You know, on behalf of all the disciplined forces in this country, their creation is a constitutional organs that are created by the Constitution. Article 244 and 245 of the Constitution creates the National Police Service with the mandate to provide internal security. The symbol that Kenyans gave them for identification is the crown. The police officer assaulted was wearing the symbol of national security, the crown. The attacker did not attack a policeman. He attacked the national sovereignty of the Republic. He attacked 55 million Kenyans. That is how grave this attack on a police officer is. Yona, what is the net effect of that attack? The American police services failed in Haiti. The world picked Kenya to provide police to go to Haiti. A confirmation that the Kenya police is the best trained. This image globally is a serious dent to our reputation as a country. It has a bearing on our pride as a nation.